Welcome to A2PC. Today we've got a little bonus video here today. This is on graphing logarithms, and I like to call little things like this an opportunity to take a breath and kind of regroup and gain our footing back with something that's brand new, and it kind of shifts our thinking a little bit. So these paradigm shift kind of lessons. Sometimes it's nice to just step back and take a breath. So let's go back through what we've uncovered about logarithms so far, and then how that pertains to their graphs. So I think this is should be a nice little exercise to kind of follow along and maybe see what's really happening here. So first of all, when we first introduced what a logarithm is, we said it's the perfect exponent that will change the base of it into the argument. So for an example, log base 5 of 125 is 3, because on a base of 5, the perfect exponent, the logarithm, equals 3 to create a 125. That's because 3 equals the perfect exponent to put on a base 5 to turn it into 125. So an equivalent expression, it's a new way of writing this exponential, but solving for the exponent. So let's take this and adjust our thinking. What could we put into a logarithm that has a certain base to produce clean outputs? So if we have, underneath here, I've got some examples. If we have a log with a certain base and we know we want nice clean outputs, what x values going into the logarithm would make this pattern fit? So for the first one, and I would challenge you to pause the video right now and see if you can come up with the answers right here. And I would guess that many of you could. So go ahead and do that and give that a shot. And then hopefully, you've done so, and now we can take a look at it. So for the first one, 5 to the negative first is going to equal this x value. So I would love to have an x inside that is 5 to the negative first power. Right, if I put a 1/5 into that logarithm, then a base of 5 to turn it into a 1/5, a nice clean output of negative 1 comes out. Okay, for the next one, what would I put in here to get a nice clean output of 0? Well, I would want 5 to the 0 power, so that would be a 1. Okay, and what if I wanted a perfect output, a perfect exponent of 1? Well, then on my base of 5, I would want 5 to the first power. And then for the next one, on my base of 5, I would want the argument, in order to get a clean output of 2, I would want a 25 in there. So see how these are x values, what we would usually have as inputs. You can kind of sneak a peek at the tables down below. That's kind of what we're trying to fill in. What are those perfect values inside so that we get nice clean powers, get those nice clean perfect exponents as outputs? So again, for this next set, we've got some log base 7. And we're trying to find some nice clean inputs that will give us these really good outputs. So again, I challenge you to pause the video and see what you can come up with for these answers before moving on. And here we go. So for the first one, what I would like in here is to have a 7 to the negative first power. And for the next one, 7 to the 0th power. And then 7 to the first power. And then 7 to the second power. So we're getting those values in the argument that make that nice perfect exponent relationship hold. All right, so I really, really hope that that has hopefully answered some of your questions, like on a general sense, like what are we trying to accomplish here? So now I've got some examples of logarithmic functions, and we're going to make a full table of values. So remember, our goal is to have clean outputs coming out, but we've got to carefully choose our x values that go in because they're going into the argument. So here I've got a logarithm base 3. I'm thinking, hey, some really nice exponents would be different powers of 3, like 3 to the negative first, 3 to the 0th, 3 to the second, 3 to the third, because those are all bases of 3 with some exponent on them. Okay, so I'm going to choose a 1/3 because that's 3 to the negative first. I'm going to choose a 1 because that's 3 to the 0. I'm going to choose a 3 because that's 3 to the first. And I'm going to choose a 9 because that's 3 to the second. now let's take a look at what comes out. And I'm going to go ahead and, write all this out just so you can kind of see it happen. Okay, so to find f of x when my x is 1/3, let's just imagine log base 3 of 1/3, and then I subtract 1 afterwards. This minus 1 is not included in the logarithm. All right, it's something that's happening after. So if I were to carry this out, let's just think, okay, with the logarithm itself, what turns a base of 3 into a 1/3? That perfect exponent, that logarithm is a negative 1, and then I subtract the 1 afterwards. So this is a negative 2. For the next one, what's the perfect exponent to turn a base of 3 into 1, right? That's the x value that we're plugging in, and then I'll subtract 1. Okay, that perfect exponent is a 0. A 0 power will turn its base into 1, and then we subtract 1. For the next one, okay, now our x value, our input is 3, and then we'll subtract 1 afterwards. The perfect exponent to turn a base of 3 into 3 is a first power, and then minus 1. So you can kind of see the pattern emerging in our outputs if we've carefully chosen the x values along the way to do the same thing. Okay, and for the last one, what's the perfect exponent to turn a base of 3 into 9? Well, that perfect exponent is 2. So once I find that logarithm, then I subtract the 1 afterwards. I'm doing 2 minus 1. It's 1. So I'm hoping that this gives you a little bit of clarity. It just kind of seeing some of these worked out, taking our time and going through and evaluating, showing all of our little simplifying steps along the way. Sometimes just taking a breath and a couple minutes of our time to do that can really, really pay off. All right, so let's try this second one. G of x is 2 minus log base 6 of x. So realize that the parent function here, the core of this function g, is a log base 6. Then we multiply it by negative 1, and then we add 2. So times negative 1, and then plus 2. So we want to make this logarithm happy first. Then we can do the other math outside afterwards. So I'm thinking, what are good values to plug into a log base 6? Well, kind of like with our log base 3 beforehand, I'd love if that x were a 1 over 6. I'd like if it were a 1 or a 6 or a 36. And we could choose more, right? We could choose different powers on 6, but that's what we want to kind of drive this thing. So again, down here, I'm just going to kind of grind through what are some of these outputs going to look like. Okay, so first, what happens when I plug a 1/6 into that log base 6? Then I would have 2 minus log base 6 of 1/6. Let's figure out the logarithm. The perfect exponent to turn a base of 6 into a 1/6 is a negative 1. So I've got 2 minus a negative 1. Next, 2 minus log base 6 of 1 is my new input to the logarithm. 2 minus, okay, what's the perfect exponent to turn a 6 into a 1? That's a 0 power. So I've got 2 minus 0. Okay, and then next, 2 minus log base 6 of 6. Well, that's 2 minus, and then the perfect exponent to turn a 6 into a 6 is a first power. And then lastly, 2 minus log base 6 of 36. Well, okay, let's figure out what that logarithm is. The perfect exponent to put on a base of 6 to make 36 is 2. And you probably could have guessed that a 0 was going to go here just because we chose powers on 6 that went up by 1. We're expecting that the logarithm, the perfect exponent, is going up by 1. But in this case, it's going down by 1 because that logarithm was negative. But again, I hope we're getting a feel for this. Okay, so I'm going to take a second and clear this out. Alrighty. Next one, h of x. Getting to this point, maybe I hope that you're saying, oh, okay, I think I got this. So I would challenge you for either h of x or j of x. Again, pause the video, look at that function, see if you can come up with the table of values and make that work for you, because I think if you can do that, man, we're in a good place. Now, the really interesting thing about this h of x, though, is that look at the argument. It's not just an x anymore. So it's not like I want the x to be 1 over 6 like last time. There was just an x inside. So now my input area of the logarithm, the argument, is a little bit more complicated. So it's like, okay, inside that logarithm, I would love if that 3 minus x, that argument inside, I would just love if that were a 1 over 4, since it's a base 4 logarithm. I would also love if that 3 minus x were a 1, 4 to the 0th power. I would love if 3 minus x were 4, 4 to the 1st power. And I would love if 3 minus x were 16, that would be 4 to the 2nd power. And so you can see that each time, instead of just saying x equals, now that I've got a more complicated logarithm, I'm saying, hey, I want the argument to equal this. And that'll help me find those really nice x values. So it's an extra step for sure, but it's something that I think we can totally carry out. So we would subtract 3. That's subtracting 12 fourths. And then we would divide away the negative. For the next one, it's a little bit easier. I would add x and subtract 1 from both sides. If x equaled 2, I think we could figure that one out. I don't need to say x equals there, though, just a 2. For the next one, if this were a negative 1, 3 minus a negative 1 would make a 4. And if I had a negative 13, we would get that. Now, it's a little bit of extra work, I know, and it's kind of a tough sell on my part to get you to do this extra work when you could just type it into a calculator, and you still have that option. But please realize that what we're doing here is we're using the ability of like understanding what a logarithm does, and once we kind of see that and once we get a couple under our belt, I think you'll find that this is I would argue that it's a pretty quick method. But all we're doing is we're saying, hey, you know, with the stuff inside, we want it to make these powers of 4. Now we just have a little bit of extra work to make x produce those. So we've chosen our x values, but we know what's coming out of the logarithm, right? We've got a 1/4, or what's going into the logarithm, a 4 and a 16. So for my h of x over here, for the first one, I'm going to have log base 4. And I know that this 11 over 4 is going to make a 1/4 inside. So that output's just going to be that perfect negative first power to turn a base of 4 into 1/4. For the next one, I've done all the work to know that it's going to make a 1 inside. If I plug an x value of 2 in there, and we could just go back to this each time if you wanted, but we've already done the legwork over here. So I know that that's going to make a 1 inside the logarithm. I know that's going to be a 0 power. Okay, the next one, I know it's going to produce a 4. When I use x being negative 1, I know that's going to make a 4 inside that logarithm. What's the perfect exponent? Well, here it's a 1. And for the last one, I know that when I plug in this x value of negative 13, it's going to make 16 inside that logarithm. So I know the perfect power has to be a 2. And so it's just this really, really, really nice look at following an input all the way through and just kind of contorting the function to output the really, really nice things that we want to see. All right, so now the last one, the J of X. And I made this one deliberately tough, right? It's got a tough input area, tough argument in the logarithm. Plus, it's got a times 4 out front and a plus 1 afterwards. So really, as far as transformations go or like algebra work that we have to do, you're not going to see one that has more steps than this. Okay, so let's get to it. I know that inside this log base 5, I would love to have in there, instead of 3x minus 2, I would love to have a 1/5. I would love to have that 3x minus 2. I would love to have that make a 1 inside. I would love to have it make a 5, and I would love to have it make a 25. So my really nice clean x values, and these won't always show up in a calculator table either. So these really nice x values, well, let's see what's going to happen. I would add 2 to both sides. And then I'd divide by 3. If I have 11 over 5 and I divide by 3, essentially I make the denominator 3 times as big. But again, it doesn't matter how nasty this looks because I know what it's going to produce inside. It's going to make a 1/5 in there. All right, for the next one, I would add 2 and divide by 3. Hey, this one's pretty nice. I would have 3x equals 3. That'd be x equaling 1 in there. All right, and we probably could have done that one in our heads. Okay, for the next one, I want that 3x minus 2 to make a 5 inside. So I would add 2 and divide by 3. Add 2 and divide by 3. Hey, that's pretty nice as well. I guess I could show a little bit more of the algebra here on this side. I got a little excited. Okay, but again, these x values, they look kind of sloppy, don't they? But we've chosen them very, very carefully because they're going to take that 3x minus 2, the argument to the logarithm, and they're going to create really nice powers of 5 in this log base 5. All right, so now let's talk about what comes out of j of x. So now I've got 4 times the logarithm, log base 5, and we know that 11 fifteenths, if I plug that in, that'll make a 1 fifth inside, and then I've got to add 1 afterwards. So this is really 4 times negative 1 plus 1, because I know that perfect power to turn a 5 into a 1 fifth, I know that logarithm represents a negative 1. For the next one, hey, 1. I know that was what would produce a 1 inside. That's really, really nice. So in this case, 4 times log base 5 of 1 plus 1. I know that perfect logarithm is a 0. I'm doing 4 times 0 plus 1. That's kind of neat that all those came out to be 1s. So that's pretty cool. Next, the 7 thirds. I know that's going to make a 5 inside. So I've got 4 times log base 5 of 5. Plus 1. That's 4 times, this perfect power is 1. That's going to be a 5. And take a look at this pattern here. Plus 4, plus 4. I would expect that this is also going to make a 9. Let's see if that happens. 4 times log base 5. Let's see. I know that an input of 9 will make a 25 inside. And then plus 1. Okay, what is that logarithm? What is that perfect exponent? It's a 2. So 4 times 2 plus 1, sure enough, there's our 9. So yeah, it may require a little bit of extra scratch work and a little bit of head scratching on top of our scratch work, but I would strongly encourage that you take some time to think about what goes into a function, what are the nice outputs we're hoping to get out, how can we make the function give us really nice clean outputs, how can we use that definition of a logarithm to help us out. It's a perfect exponent. So we want nice 5 to the something powers in the argument, then we just use those powers when we go to evaluate. Again, I hope this was a helpful exercise, and I hope this ties together the idea of the nature of logarithms and how they work, and how we can kind of manipulate those to really help us out in this graphing circumstance. Thanks for watching.